At a time when guitars were mostly commercially built and manufactured, John DeAngelico was a custom guitar maker. He ended up becoming the finest archtop guitar maker of the period. The first time I met him, I walked in the shop and he had just finished a brand new guitar, a big blonde New Yorker. It was really unbelievable. I never saw anything like that. He says, "You want to try it?" He says, "No, just be careful." I sat down on the stool and he put it in my hand. I played a couple of chords on it. I couldn't believe the sound of it. One Saturday, he says, "Geez, I could come here every day." He says, "Oh, no, you can't." Because he was in a bad mood that particular day. It's the kind of person he was. So I said, "Oh, okay, anything you say, you know." And he must have liked me because I'd never come on smart or wise guy or anything like that. So I guess he finally decided, I guess we'll try him. As a teacher, you know, he'd show you something and he'd say, "This is how I do it. You can do it either my way or your own way, but it better come out as good or better than I do it." I guess I molded actually the way he wanted me to be. As I'm carving it, I'm actually taking weight off the piece of wood, and piece of wood is changing its sound. It's getting mellower. I can tell how it's ringing by the vibration I'm feeling in my fingers. The bracings are made from spruce, the same as the top is. They have to fit perfectly. In other words, the same contours that the top has, the highs, the lows, the shallow points and everything, that brace has to fit with no spacing at all, because if you glue it in and there's even a hairline opening, it could cause a vibration that could drive you out of your mind. So that's why the brace has to be solid, like one piece. So if you hit the note, the brace carries the sound to all four corners of the instrument. I use a cross brace, like an open scissor. When you open the brace up, it gives you a slower vibration. As you tighten the brace up, the vibrations are faster, so it gives you a brighter type of sound. My great-grandfather, he was a cabinet maker. My grandfather was a custom tailor. And my mother, she was a designer, mostly handcraft things. My father was a tool and die maker. So every place I went, everybody was using their hands. To get into it physically, mentally, I get stronger into what I'm doing, and I like that. If I had to sit there and think, if I had to figure out the equation for energy and all that kind of, I could never do that. My mind just doesn't work that way. But the more physical and direct it is, the better I can work at it. That's the way I create, that way, physical. from the time I was small, you know, there was always music around. My grandfather with the operas, and my uncles all played mandolin and violin and accordion. And it'd be like, 15, 20 people in the house all the time. Every weekend it was like a big feast. I was always interested in the music.
Well, I bet you see what's going on there. I know it's hard to see.
Gradually, I got more interested in the guitar. And this friend of mine we used to play together, he told me about D'Angelico. So would you like to see where they make the best guitars in the world?
Well, yeah, it was a great time of life when we were working for D'Angelico down on Kenmare Street, because Chuck Wayne, Johnny Smith, Tony Mottola, Les Paul, all the top players, I mean, they come into D'Angelico's and I would be there.
In 1959, I was doing a lot of the heavy work and John was doing all the finer things because he was much older. And, you know, he did all the carving and putting the necks on it. But then when he got sick, I gradually started to do that myself. See, around 1963, I could make a guitar on my own, but I never did it. It was always with his guide. He was always there, always there. But when he died in 64, then all of a sudden, bam.
You know, you're with somebody for 12, 13 years, you know, standing over you, and then all of a sudden he's not there. Even if you never asked him a question, you knew everything to do, you still had the security of him being around. All of a sudden, it was just completely cut off. I had to just start my own little world of my own. I had to get started. I figured, why wouldn't a guy like me that worked for D'Angelico for 12 years, why wouldn't everybody just come running to the door and saying, okay, I want a guitar? Actually, what I had to do was prove myself to most of these guys, including people in the business, other dealers, and I wanted to buy tuning pegs. You know, they say, oh, well, we know John, we don't know you. You see some kind of credit, who are you? It sounds funny, but it really was like that. The emotion was so heavy inside of me that nobody would give me a break. So I just said to myself, look, you know you can build a damn thing. I don't want to do repairs the rest of my life. I want to make a guitar. I can make a guitar. The first 10 guitars I made, they were just D'Angelico's. And all I did was put the Quistos on the headpiece. And somebody would see the guitar and go, hey, what'd you get? It was a new D'Angelico? It was very, very satisfying. It turned out just the way I wanted it to turn out. The celluloid binding is made of the same substance that the glue is made out of. It's acetone, it's the solvent. As soon as the acetone hits this stuff, it begins to melt. So what happens is when I start bending this thing around the guitar, it actually melts. So the wood absorbs it, like sucks it in like a sponge. And I only have maybe about 5 to 10 minutes before it hardens and I won't be able to get it off again, you know, without causing some kind of a rip in the wood. I guess mostly every guitar player, if he could build his own guitar, he would build his own guitar because it would be exactly the way he wanted it.
I mean, there's some fellas that I know were friends and everything. They've owned my guitars and they've sold them. There's a certain feeling I have, you know, like, damn it, I couldn't satisfy them, or why didn't you work with me a little bit? Maybe we could have gotten it with a little patience and work. It could be the guitar they want it to be.
Joe Puma goes back for years. He's into the guitar
physically, not just the playing end of it, but trying to figure out why can't a guitar sound better? Why can't it do this better?
Hey, it sounds nice.
I think I made Joe two guitars. He liked them, but he ended up selling them because they just weren't what he wanted. I bet you he's had to own 50 guitars, and every one of them he sold. So finally, he says he had an idea for a guitar. He would like it to be this way, that way. So I said, look it. Come on out and build it.
You know, it's the longest I've ever owned a guitar.
It's the first time you really liked it that much.
Yeah. Really?
I got something I want you to try. Wait a minute. I just finished it.
Will it make me younger?
Most likely. It's making me older.
That's what I'm... Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Oh, gee whiz.
Let's see what happens with it.
Oh, this looks beautiful. Give it the test. Play some blues with me.
Bear with me.
Love.
All right, but take it easy. I'm actually into a trap where I have 5-6 years of back orders, and it's 5 or 6 years of the same guitar again and again. It's the players themselves that say, I want that guitar. I can't change it. I can't say, well, look, how's about I got an idea for... What do you mean? Well, what, do you want to experiment on me? I get that kind of an answer.
You know, and I'm not building 100 a day. I'm building one guitar a month.
God, not bad.
The fingerboard is actually one of the most important custom parts of the guitar because no guitar player has the same size hand, and his style of playing varies, so the fingerboard naturally has to be fit and formed according to his size of his hand and the way he plays. I make the fingerboard out of ebony because it's very hard and it produces a bright, clean sound. It doesn't absorb the notes that you play on it, so the guitar is very responsive. Is made separately, and the neck are made separately, and then the two are finally joined together to make the guitar. And that's probably the most critical point, because there's angles to contend with, the pitch of the neck, how it's glued on, how strong and accurate the dovetail is, because the stronger and more secure that joint is, the better the guitar is going to sound. That's the secret, so that when you play the note on the guitar, it's solid, it rings out better, and the reason is because of that joint. Most of the companies do them by machine. Some glue, bang, they bang it in, and that's it. But the way I make mine, I try to make them so perfectly that once they're put together, if you try to steam it or apart or electrically heat them, something, you couldn't get them apart anymore. It's a scary part because you actually can ruin what you've taken weeks to put together. You can't put a piece of wood in there, glue it all up, and start all over again. You've ruined it. So the first one I did after D'Angelico died took me 2 days to put in. Now it's 15 years since I've been doing it. And now, maybe it'll take me 3 hours to do.
Mm-hmm.
when I first started to make the guitars on my own after John died. In the beginning, I was making them more or less traditional sunburst and natural blonde. I guess I wanted them to start to have an appearance all their own. And I started to come up with some different colors, like a honey color or a more violin color. It's not just the color itself, it's the way I apply it to the guitar. It's the fan, the type of a sunburst I put into the guitar, how I blend it into the center, the lights to the darks. That's the whole thing that actually makes it, not just the color alone. The idea for the ebony tail piece on the guitar just came from the violin and the cello. The guitar had a metal tail piece, and it produced a metallic overtone, where the ebony doesn't do that. It vibrates as wood would, but it doesn't add any extra note the way a metal tail piece does. The strings actually make the top vibrate. The bridge transmits the sound from the strings down into the top of the guitar. By controlling the size of the bridge, I can control the amount of air I'm going to vibrate inside of the guitar. That's what keeps it even more interesting. I can actually alter the guitar. I can always change the sound towards what the player wants. I first met Jim Hall, it was around 1954, when he first came into New York, and he came down to D'Angelico's and ordered an electric guitar. This is gonna sound different on the amplifier tonight, you know.
With the new strings.
With the new strings.
Yeah, that's okay.
It's gonna be kind of brighter sound. Yeah. I built two guitars for Jim. One was the New Yorker model, a 17-inch acoustic, and the other one was a 16-inch electric guitar. It could be that little dip that you have in there, too, besides.
And my fingers. String. Could you check my fingers?
Yeah, okay. Oh, my God, no wonder. You're playing them opposite way. There's a lot of guys out there that like that calm, musical, you know, melodic way you play, and it makes you think, makes you listen. I'm gonna make. And it seems like the newer ones I've been making seem to be more sensitive and have a different sound to them, because actually I'm changing myself as I'm getting older. My whole concept and what I think of the guitar itself is changing. Player, and if he likes it that much and I really satisfied him that much, well, he'd consider it to be the perfect guitar. But naturally, I'd love it. I'd say, oh, it's a beautiful instrument. But the next one I'd make, I'd automatically forget that last one I made. There may be a few within my, in my mind that I may remember as
fine instruments, but never the perfect one. It's never there. That's what makes you go on to the next one. I build about 130 arch-top acoustic, 10 or 12 flat-top guitars, about 5 or 6 mandolins. I've built about 20 electric guitars, hollow-body electric guitars, and maybe 7 or 8 solid bodies. I made guitars 15 years ago. I've never even seen them. Never saw them again. I've heard of some gotten destroyed. Some I've seen other guys work on, refinished, cut holes in them, put pickups into them. You know, it really gets to you. I've seen the Angelicos that some guys have completely butchered. But then there's fellas, you know, that take care of them like they yell at me if I treat it wrong. You know, say, hey, you know, Jimmy, it's mine now. Put it on a bench and bang it accidentally or tap it or something. And he's, Jimmy, you know, and he's wiping it while I'm working on it. It makes me say, wow, thank God there's fellas out there that really respect what I've done, you know, and understand it. I do think about that quite a bit, where it's going to eventually end up. Either it'll be destroyed or it'll be in somebody's hands that really loves it. He's there, out there someplace.
Thank you.